Welcome to the Risks and Results, Counter Risks to the Nation's Critical Infrastructure session. I'd like to introduce our first speaker of this morning. His name is Christopher Krebs. He's the director of the U.S. Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency. So if you could please give him your attention and a warm welcome. Thank you.
But most importantly, once we have that understanding, we've got to share it. We have to share it with the blue team, have to share it with the network defenders. We have to do it in a timely, timely, actionable kind of way. And sometimes, when we go through our risk assessment process, sometimes we have to act. And I'll talk a little bit about that in just a moment. But we also have to be disciplined. And what I really mean by that is I'm a firm believer in defense in depth. I'm also a firm believer in not adding additional layers onto that defense in depth approach. We focus on finding those layers where we can be the most effective and have the biggest return on investment. So when we issue alerts, when we issue directives, that's our mentality. Not trying to saddle you up as defenders with more work, with more action. Because your job's hard enough. Doing the basics is hard enough. So let's just get that part right. So as I think about what the risk landscape looks like as we take this approach on understanding and sharing and acting, I think about it from two different angles. One is the threat. What do we get from the intelligence community? What do I get from the private sector to help enrich our understanding of what's really happening out there in the ecosystem? So one is the threat. But there are a whole lot of people focused on threat. I have to focus on what it means. And we have to ask two questions every day in our jobs. One is, so what? You give me this piece of information, so what? What does it mean? What's the impact? What's the risk? And the second piece is, okay, now that I'm scared to death, what do I do about it? In some cases, scared to death. What do we do about it? So to the threat piece, we're typically, right now at least, focused on four primary actors, the big four: Russia, China, Iran, North Korea. Last year, 2018, we issued a number of bulletins, technical alerts. Some are directly attributable or attributed to a nation state actor. Some are amplifications of vendor notifications, and those may have their own attributions, but we don't necessarily have the intelligence to support that. But nonetheless, for North Korea last year, we issued 9 technical alerts on a number of their activities, primarily financially motivated, ransomware, things like that. Russia, we issued 3. One was an attribution on NotPetya of 2017. Another one was on activity targeting network infrastructure devices. And a third was last summer, was a repeat of a prior alert, but again, an attribution on Russian targeting of U.S. critical infrastructure. On Iran, about this time last year, we issued an alert on a Mabna Institute indictment that the law enforcement community issued in a password spraying attack. Lastly, on China, just this past December, we issued an attribution with our law enforcement partners on activity of APT-10 or Cloud Hopper, targeting managed service providers and some cloud service providers. So our ideal here is to issue information so that you, network defenders, can take action. Includes TTPs, indicators of compromise, other information that you can turn on and you can act on. But at the same time, we have other products, services, and capabilities that are designed to make your job easier. But if I've learned anything over the last 2 years, it's that we can't do everything. We can't do everything all at once. We can't take a one-size-fits-all approach. So we have a number of offerings, a number of services. One example is the automated indicator sharing program. Everybody's probably hopefully heard about it at one time or another. But what we're looking at is the original intent and design, particularly the congressional intent of this program, and feedback. Because as a voluntary organization, if I'm not providing value to the blue team, why am I here? Why is Congress entrusting me taxpayer dollars to do my job? So what we're doing is based on our understanding, AIS was originally set up for velocity and volume. Now what we've, and don't get me wrong, people have found value in this program. But the feedback we're getting is the more sophisticated users, in part, are overwhelmed. So if my job is to make yours easier, volume doesn't necessarily help. What you need is context. What you need is specificity. So we're going through some program improvements, adding additional context, flags if it's a nation state actor, sightings to understand prevalence in the ecosystem. And these upgrades and updates will be rolling out over the course of the next couple months. But that's based on, again, feedback. I can't do anything if it's not providing, I shouldn't be doing anything if it's not providing value. On the risk side of the equation, we've also shifted the way that we're trying to understand what's happening out there in the world. What I mean by that is historically we've looked at critical infrastructure, domestically at least, from a 16 sector company asset approach. What we found is that you lose the forest at that point because you're focused on the trees. So what we're trying to do is pull it out a little bit and take an understanding of what are the functions within our nation's critical infrastructure. What are the services that they provide? And when you take this approach, you get a more systemic understanding of our nation's infrastructure, of interdependencies, points of aggregation. And that is allowing us to get that better sense of risk. Now, the downside is, as we go through this approach, we understand that we have a whole lot of work to do to really understand risk that's out there. And nowhere, in my view at least, is that more apparent than supply chain. We don't yet have a understanding, particularly quantifiable, quantitative, metric-based understanding of vendor supply chain risk, third-party supply chain risk, also customer interactions. So in terms of how we're working through addressing risk in the ecosystem, I took the opportunity, it's kind of forced upon me by Congress, over the 35-day shutdown period, to take a little bit of a strategic pause across the organization. We had been moving 1,000 miles a minute over the last at least 2 years since I've been here. And we took that 35-day period, I did at least, to say, we're doing a whole lot of stuff. What are the things over the next 18 months to 2 years that are going to be most important? So we came out with a list of five, but for the purposes of this conversation, four key priorities. At the top of that is China, supply chain, and 5G. No matter how hard I try, I cannot disentangle those three. They are fundamentally interrelated. The second priority is federal network security. The third is critical infrastructure cybersecurity. And I mean by that, at least for the purposes of this conversation, industrial control systems and SCADA security. And fourth is election security. So my team has a pretty clear understanding of what we need to be looking at from a mission risk and mission opportunity space over the next 18 months. Obviously some natural rationales for that. So let me start about how we're doing that. So with the supply chain conversation, we have a few things going on, but one of them is last summer we established a supply chain task force. Now, task forces abound in the federal government, but this one is focused on a few things, but it brings together the federal government, the IT community, and the communications industry, 20 reps from each, bring them together, and try to get our arms around what the approaches are. They didn't say effective approaches, but the approaches are to managing supply chain risk. We'll get to that effective part. And within that task force, we've got a couple work streams going. First and foremost is, what does a bi-directional threat sharing framework look like? So the government can effectively share information with industry, and industry can share back to government. Second is criteria for effective risk assessments and threat assessments within the supply chain. Third is, what does a criteria set look like for a qualified bidders list and qualified manufacturers list? And finally, what are some incentives or recommendations for incentives for original manufacturers, buying from original manufacturers and resellers? We're also doing a few other things on 5G, seems to be the hot topic right now. But one of the key priorities, or the key things that we're driving through right now, is a strategic risk assessment of 5G, working with industry on that, but understanding what are the key points of influence and intervention for risk management as we move towards 5G. My concern right now is that we haven't scoped the conversation, at least in Washington, D.C. So in part, at a strategic level, trying to inform this conversation on the Hill, across the interagency and the policy circles, so that when we do pass or issue policy, we do take action, that we've scoped the problem the right way. More to come on that. Federal networks, we've been pretty busy even during the shutdown. We issued an emergency directive, the first of its kind, on DNS hijacking. So it came clear to us after a private sector partner reached out to us in early January that there was a global campaign underway where certain actors, malicious cyber actors, were hijacking DNS traffic globally. It wasn't just the US, but it was a global campaign. So as we looked at it, this was something that we didn't actually monitor for, we didn't really defend for. So when I think again about that layered defense model, it's focusing on issuing recommendations where we can be effective, where we can get return on investment. We issued this directive, took action over a 10-day period, and we were able to, these agencies, the federal agencies, took the action needed to harden their infrastructure, but also ensure if they were subject to one of these attacks, they'd be able to tell. Now, the interesting thing about DHS when we issue directives is that others take notice. Kind of like NIST develops special publications that are targeted at federal government, well, other folks pay attention too. So with great power comes great responsibility. So we've got to think about these directives we issue and who else might be listening, who else might want to take guidance from us. And we actually heard from a large city CISO that it was a helpful directive for him to understand. We took the same approach in September of 2017 when we issued a binding operational directive banning Kaspersky antivirus products from federal networks. Others took notice and others took action. They evaluated their risk and they took action. On critical infrastructure cybersecurity, we're really focused right now on industrial control systems. It's an area where we have the least understanding or the least mature understanding of what's happening out there in the ecosystem. So we have a couple different programs that we've kicked off, but one of them is the Pipeline Cybersecurity Initiative, where we're partnering with the Transportation Security Administration and the Department of Energy, working with pipeline companies to understand where the risk is. What are they doing to manage that risk? What are the things that we can do from providing assessments, both boots on the ground, but also self-assessment tools? We're also working with industry on deploying sensors to, again, look at what's happening. What is the adversary doing out in the space? The last priority I mentioned is election security. So in 2018, We worked with all 50 states, the District of Columbia, and 1,400 local jurisdictions. We set up an ISAC focused on election infrastructure that got over 1,400 members signed up, enrolled, and playing a part in about 9 months. It's the fastest ISAC to reach that level of participation of any other ISAC. That's a big deal. We also issued a number of sensors, IDS, and intrusion detection sensors, out across state networks. In 2016, we had those sensors out there too, but we only covered 32% of election infrastructure or votes cast under election infrastructure. By the 2018 election, we had over 90% covered. That's a big deal. What did we do with those sensors, though, is the question. We worked with the intelligence community to understand what the risk was. We worked together to understand what the risk was across state and local infrastructure, and then we're able to take classified signatures, declassify, load them up into those sensors and protect elections. We had a first-of-its-kind tabletop exercise with state and local officials. Never been done before. 44 states in the District of Columbia. We're going to do it again this year. And we're going to do it again the year after, and then the year after, and then the year after. That's here to stay. Just like FEMA does the great shakeout exercise, the city knows that better than anybody, we're going to do these every single year going forward. Because it helped. It made a difference. So, as I wrap this up, I'm trying to think about all the things I've learned in the last couple years between the 2016 election, the 2018 election, working with our stakeholders. The one thing that stands out to me the most is that we can't do everything. We can't work in generalities. We have to be much more focused. We have to pick the things that we're going to make a difference on. But we can do it together. Collective defense is a concept that we've been working on for the last 2 years. Collective defense, to me, this is not the NATO Article 5 definition of collective defense. But from a blue team perspective, what collective defense means to me is everybody has some piece of information about what's going on out there. Whether it's an APT tactic, technique, procedure, or some vulnerability that's out there. Everybody's got something. But if it's just sitting out there, or if it's just in the hands of one person, we're not getting the full maximum effect. We've got to bring it in together. We've got everybody working towards the same goal. But again, generalities don't help us in this space. We need to work together. We have to work together. So what I want everybody in this room to do, just do one thing. Protect 2020. How are we going to do this? We're going to do three things. Preach, plan, participate. What I mean by that is you're all experts in information security and cybersecurity. When you go home, engage your election officials. Let them know that you are there to help. Help them. Preach the gospel of InfoSec. We are resources. It's not just about pointing out what's wrong. It's helping them understand and get through the challenges that they face, whether it's resources, technical proficiency, or whatever. So preach. But also plan. Plan. Get your plan together for 2020. Know the rules. Know the voter registration rules. Know the provisional ballot rules. But get your plan together for what your 2020 participation looks like. But lastly, and most importantly, participate. Whether you're going to volunteer, whether you're going to just vote, participate. Engage in the process. Engage and encourage people to participate in election security and national security efforts. Whether it's working with me, working with the state election officials, it doesn't matter. Participate. So to put a bow on this, collective defense can work. We can work together. If you have anything election security related, get it to me, I'll get it that people can do something about it. Let's enable, let's empower the blue team, let's empower the network defender, but above all, let's protect 2020. Thank you.
Cilluffo to join us on stage. He is the director of the McCrary Institute for Cyber and Critical Infrastructure Security at Auburn University. Welcome.
Sounds like a similar name to CISA, by the way. So thank you. And Chris, thanks for an amazing overview in terms of where CISA and the Department of Homeland Security is going. I feel your positive momentum. You're hitting your stride. I think most importantly, you're no longer trying to boil oceans. You're focusing on things you can actually make a difference on, and I think that should be applauded. With that as a backdrop, and I promise not to go too deep into inside the Beltway discussion, but the name change and the fact that CISA was legislated just this past November, what does that mean, other than from a branding standpoint, for the women and men under your charge, under CISA? How has it changed their day-to-day lives, if at all?
Well, it did a few things for us, and I see we have some congressional staff in the room, so thank you, and thank you to your bosses for everything you've done for us over the last year. You hit the branding point, but it's really important to underscore the recruitment aspect of the name change. You know, previously we'd go to job fairs or even RSA, we'd have a booth or a banner that says the National Protection Programs Directorate, which I
already forgot that acronym, by the way.
I used to make a joke about how it sounds like a Soviet era military intelligence unit. Turns out I wasn't that far off. There's NKVD, which was military intelligence, but actually, turns out that NPPD was a chemical marker that Soviet intelligence used to use to track people in Russian territory or Soviet territory. So they'd actually mark them with this chemical NPPD. So I'm probably going to stop using that joke. You're getting all the time over the last couple years. But yeah, the brand, the recruitment piece, it also gives us the opportunity to streamline the organization internally. It was a legacy organization that stitched together some unlike functions. And so we have to transition out some of those historical functions. But you know, bringing it back to the top, it really is about giving us a brand, giving us the ability to go out and engage. And 2016 is a great example. You know, when we knocked on the door for some election officials, they're like, who the heck are you? I don't understand what this thing is. But now, you know, it cuts through the decision cycles pretty quickly.
I want to pull on elections and election security in a second. But prior to going to that, you had mentioned at the very top of the list of priorities was China, supply chain, and 5G. Right. And I mean, Huawei seems to be on a major charm campaign these days, but I'd be very curious, looking at those sorts of issues, looking at the unprecedented actions you took in 2017 vis-a-vis Kaspersky, any right. lessons learned there from a supply chain perspective? And what should we think right. from foreshadowing in terms of 5G going forward?
So when I think about supply chain risk management, we're trying not to take kind of a whack-a-mole approach. We're trying to create a framework for procurement, acquisition, or whatever the deployment is. So the kind of underpinnings of the Kaspersky Binding Operational Directive in September of 17 was, you know, kind of four questions. What's the thing? What's it do? Who has access to it? And who are they beholden to? And so in the case of Kaspersky, it's basically a root level access below what we tend to monitor for. And the data went back to Moscow that was subject to the SOARM law and other laws in Russia that granted the FSB and the GRU access to information. And you know, I don't tend to trust the Russian legal system. We did a pretty detailed analysis of it. And so that gave me pause. That meant that these nation state military and intelligence services had access to federal, you know, theoretically had access to federal networks.
And that's when you were NPPD and they thought you might have some sway in Russia.
So,
sorry.
So, you know, we
your joke, not mine.
We, We conducted our own risk assessment and said this is just not a tenable position for U.S. government federal networks. And so we issued the binding operational directive. And the kind of the punchline is, like I mentioned with the DNS emergency directive, is others took notice and they conducted their own risk assessments and said, you know what, I can't live with this either. But again, it's up to everyone to take their own risk assessment in the Kaspersky case. So as I think about that framework of what is it, what does it do, who does it have, who has access to it, and what laws are they bound to, and I think going forward, particularly for these transformational leaps we're about to make in technology, I kind of boil down to what's the transparency in the system? What's the trust in the system? So there's been this charm offensive you talk about, and there's been some aspersions thrown at U.S. companies about the U.S. legal system. But, you know, I used to work for a U.S. technology company.
Pretty big one.
Yeah, but, you know, they sued the government. They took the case to the Supreme Court. It got to the point where the U.S. Congress had to pass a law to establish a framework so the U.S. law enforcement could seek lawful access to data. I'm not familiar of any sort of similar actions the Chinese companies have taken against the Chinese government or Russian companies have taken against the Russian government. So what this comes down to is actions speak louder than words. Don't tell me you're investing. Show me how you're doing it.
Exactly.
What are the transparency reports that these companies are issued? U.S. companies have this down pat. Transparency, transparency, transparency. It all boils down to trust. And if I don't trust it, I'm not going to use it.
In the words of Mark Twain, trust is the coin of the realm. And when you're talking about something as foundational as 5G, I think those are very wise words. Let's go to elections. So, and some of the steps and actions you're taking to work on electoral security with all of our partners in that region. And I'd also be curious, when we look at that issue, could that be a beachhead to enhance CISA's efforts with state, local, tribal, and territorial, which as of now only account for about 4% of DHS grant funding. So I'd be curious what your thoughts are.
Yeah, so that's actually precisely how we're looking at the issue right now. So if trust is the coin of the realm, we didn't have a whole lot of trust with election officials in 2016 or 2017. It took a lot of a concerted, focused effort by the team surging into support, but also coming kind of hat in hand with some humility, saying, look, what do you need? Here's what we can give you. What do you need? And so that all boiled down to three things: information sharing, issuing clearances, providing them security briefing, classified briefings, technical support and services, risk and vulnerability assessments, cyber hygiene scanning, which is our external facing scanning. But those technical services where there could be, whether it's a market failure or a lack of investment, doesn't matter. We're there to surge and be a backstop for election officials. And the last thing is just the general collective defense model of let's give them training. So we offer over 800 hours of training online for state and local election officials, or state and local officials in general. I talked about the exercises. So there are just basic fundamental things we can do that we are taking, and we are looking at how it's been successful in the election space. Just last week, I met with a number of governors in DC, and we had last year a ransomware awareness campaign that we ran, and we're going to circle back to again this year, because last year was a rough year for state and locals. I mean, between Atlanta, Baltimore, Mecklenburg County, Colorado Department of Transportation, it was a rough year. So what can we do to trade off that trust in the relationships we've built, in the investments we've made on state and local specific support that we can expand outside of the election officials and just general. So awesome. When I think back to my four priorities and I say federal networks, what I'm actually talking about is government networks, because I have a whole different tool set for federal networks than I do for state and local. But it will remain a priority. It's kind of the bleeding between elections and government networks.
Awesome, awesome. Some good there. And a lot of effort, I know, having heard from the election officials themselves. So keep pushing that pedal.
So as we, you know, this Protect 2020, think through three things. One is we engaged 1,400 and still do 1,400 local jurisdictions. The trick is there are about 8,800 of them, so we still have some work to do here. And how are we going to do that? We are going to continue to push and press into expanding our engagement at scale. The second is really getting to the bottom of where the risk in the system is. What are the parts of the election process, the election equipment used, the systems that manage voter registration databases? Where's the real risk? But most importantly, so what, and what are we going to do about it? So what are the resilience measures built in to the election process, whether it's provisional ballots, paper ballots, audits, auditability in general? I think if this room knows anything, if you can't audit, if you can't look at the logs, you don't know what's happening in the system. So auditability is going to be a key or a primary focus encouraging that going forward.
So you know you can't escape without me. I'm a broken record for those of us of an age that know what records are. But on this one particular topic, deterrence and cyber deterrence and the fact that the bad guys pretty much have run of the field and there have been limited consequences, that's changing. Right. That's a good thing. But you sort of have the DoD component focused on forward engagement and defending forward, DHS on the collective defense. Are we getting to the point where we have an offensive and a defensive coordinator and we can pull all these pieces together from a country's perspective? Because governments look at the world through their boxes and org charts. Right. The bad guys don't. So I'd be curious, are we getting to that point?
Well, So there's been some really interesting research lately, I think. So CrowdStrike issued a report a couple weeks ago that said Russian actors established beachhead and breakout in like 19 minutes. North Korea was just behind that at 2 hours, and then China was at 4 hours, and then Iran was at 4 hours and something minutes. So the adversary is getting faster. And I don't think, you know, I tend to, when I come to events like RSA and others, I don't preach about the threat, the numbers, and all that, because you guys know that. You experience that intimately. So at the same time, though, FireEye issued this report that said the defense from detection to investigation timeline had dropped from almost 60 minutes down to about 50 minutes or something in that range. So we're getting a little bit better on defense. Now, I also will caveat, I think the report says that drop could have been attributed to the fact that some of the attacks were ransomware and kind of like hit you right in the face when your machine's locked up. But, you know, yes, the bad guys are getting better, but so is Blue Team, so are the defenders. And why is that? So when you talk about deterrence by denial, which is our space, the red team plays in the cost imposition space, I think about three audiences, but for the purposes of this conversation, two. One is CISOs, and I use that as a proxy for the broader network defender community. Mm-hmm. And the second audience is the executives or the decision makers, whether it's a CEO, board, general counsel, or a governor, CIO, whatever it is, it happens at the government level. To the CISO space, what I'm trying to do is understand what their challenges are and what they find most useful, and then tailor our services and products accordingly. And that's, you know, I mentioned the AIS, how we're adapting AIS to fit the need of the defender. But there's a softer side to this as well. And I mentioned understanding what the challenges the CISO has, the network defender has, in getting their jobs done. The good news on the second bucket of the CEOs and the boards is that the awareness level is only increasing. The risk level, the understanding of the risk environment is only increasing. But when I engage these CEOs, these boards, these general counsels, what I'm trying to do is twofold. One is help them understand what's going on in the threat environment, but also help them understand that when their CISOs or their network defenders come to them and ask for help or ask for support and investment, They mean it. They need that that support.
I want to pull on, because you had mentioned, and we're very deliberate in discussing how you're the nation's risk advisor. What does that actually mean in practice? I mean, you've got Bob Kolaski here with the National Risk Management Center. What does that mean from, again, are you getting to the point where you're if everything's a priority, right, nothing is? How do we look at lifeline sectors? How do we rack and stack that? And I'm not going to ask you to rack and stack the 17 sectors or 16 or wherever we're at.
I think it's 16 now.
Yeah. But how do we start maybe zeroing in on some of the industrial control systems or the ICS related issues? Because that tend to transcend across the lifeline sectors, electric.
So I think the best way to put this is, well, there are two ways to put this. I like them both. One is the sameness of the attack surface far exceeds the uniqueness of any one sector.
Yeah.
ICS is the best case study for that. The fundamental underlying industrial control systems, they have application-specific use cases in sectors, but you know, anywhere you go, it's going to be this brand or that brand. So to the extent that we can harmonize across these groups and bring the understanding together, that's important. Now, the second piece of this is across government. So my role is to bridge the gap between sector-specific agencies or those sector-specific applications, whether it's the Department of Energy working with the energy sector, the Department of Treasury working with the financial services sector. The problem is, though, I mentioned that sameness of the attack surface, is it all runs on the same infrastructure. It all runs on the same ICT infrastructure. And we have those exquisite relationships with the IT and comm sectors. And so we play a convening factor. And so the concept—
That's why 5G is so important. It's the underpinnings of our infrastructure, right? Here, right?
So this past summer, when we established the National Risk Management Center, which was a rebranding of an existing organization we had, but more than that, it was a mentality or philosophy shift. And what I mean by that is historically we've done kind of a lot of back office analysis that was generated by internal or other sort of demands for product and investigation and risk assessment. What we did with the National Risk Management Center was flip that concept on its head and said, okay, no more kind of Q shop from James Bond. Here's the toy. What does the industry need us to do? What does industry want us to do? So when I talk about this strategic assessment of risk in 5G, it's working with ICT and comms and making sure that we're getting the details right and that they're bringing their perspective along with the government perspective that infuses the understanding of threat. So we've got a number of initiatives under the Risk Management Center. I talked about a bunch of them already between Pipeline Cybersecurity Initiative, the Supply Chain Task Force, in elections at this point as well.
So one last question I think we'll have time for, and it's looking at countering foreign influence. And you were right to say that I think the interference in our elections was a tipping point. And I think people could acknowledge and recognize the significance and impact that had. When you look at some of the activities overseas, you sort of see Russia using Ukraine as a practice field. You see Iran using UAE and Saudi Arabia as a practice field. You see North Korea using South Korea and Japan as a practice field. You see China using everyone as a practice field. But the question is, what does that mean in terms of, are these previews, are these movies coming to a theater near you? What does this mean for 2020? And are we working with some of our allies overseas? And what more can we do to not only build the resilience, but impede the ability of these bad actors to do bad things?
So that's an incredibly
it's an easy one, right?
Timely question. Because Europe is about to go through the throes of an EU parliamentary election. I think there's going to be probably there are a number of other kind of EU state-level elections, and Russia's an active player in this space. So what can we do to take the learnings of 2018 here in the U.S., and again, hat in hand with all sorts of humility, say, look, here's what we've learned. Now, everybody does elections a little bit differently. You know, a lot of people do, you know, pen and paper. But underlying it all, there is still confidence. There's confidence in the process that's the most critical thing to protect. It's trust. It's trust in the system. And it's awareness of what's going on out there and how some of these nation states are playing the field. And when I, you know, you rattled off a bunch of actors, they have different objectives. They have different goals in mind.
Yep.
China's trying to manipulate the system. Russia's trying to disrupt the system. Okay, now that we understand that, how do we engage? How do we raise awareness? One of the things that we're sorting through right now is how do, and I mentioned this in a hearing a couple weeks ago, is what do we need to do to help users of or consumers of media and social media to think more critically about information that's being presented to them rather than just clicking and liking and sending along. There's the tactical side of countering foreign interference and influence, and I know Director Ray gave his keynote this morning. I didn't get a chance to listen, but they have the lead on the tactical response to foreign interference. Our role is to help raise awareness of what the bad guys are doing. So in the run-up to 2020, in terms of protecting 2020, yes, we're going to continue to provide technical support, information sharing, election exercise, all that good stuff for state and locals. But we need to make sure that we're giving the American people an understanding or raise the awareness of how the bad guys out there are trying to influence them and are trying to get in the middle of our decision loop. So whether it looks like a Smokey the Bear campaign or something like that, you know, we're still sorting through that, but we have a role, and see something, say something here is a great tagline for what we need to be doing.
Have you seen any other countries follow Russia's lead?
It's an active space, and it's only going to get more active. I think Russia issued the playbook in 16, and it's out there for everyone to see. So not only do we have to plan against the 2016 factors and what they came back in 2018, but we have to start innovating. We have to think about, you know, this is kind of the skating to the puck approach. We've got to think about what the opportunities for countering their influence going forward are. But 2020 for us is a top priority.
I think we're down to T minus two, but one very quick question. And you mentioned IoT and expanding attack surfaces and Internet of Everything. What is DHS doing unique, and what is CISA doing to help think through? Ideally, you want to bake security on the front end at the
right
design.
Right.
Not constantly have to bolt it on afterwards,
well,
but I'd be curious what your thinking is there.
So, you know, we issued in the past some IoT security guidance. We had a great opportunity to meet with a bunch of our foreign partners yesterday, and I tend to go out and look at what are other countries doing? What's the test lab? So the Brits, the UK has issued an IoT code of practice. What are the experiences they're having there? There's a lot of stuff in kind of the foundational there are things that are taking shape overseas. There's an IoT law in California. What are the challenges in implementing these approaches? But when I think, you know, we have a mantra, and it was in the kind of build slide at the beginning. It's defend today, secure tomorrow. And what does that really mean? Defend today is the foundational work that we as Blue Team and Network Defenders do every day. It's sharing indicators. It's the 24/7 incident response. It's the basics, foundational work, raising awareness of what China and APT-10 are doing in their targeting of specific strategic sectors or cloud or managed service providers. But secure tomorrow is the transformational work. What is it that we can do to change the way the risk landscape and the infrastructure landscape, how they're deployed? 5G is a great opportunity for one of those transformational security steps. IoT, another transformational step.
Chris, the tyranny of time requires I be a bit of a tyrant. Thanks for your leadership. Thanks for doing everything you're doing. Keep rolling. And bottom line is, don't forget your customers at the state and local and private sector and all good things. So
Got it. Thank you. So we have Protect 2020 stickers for everybody. Please. Thank you.